And we're going to be reading Acts 2, 1 through 4 today. Acts 2, 1 through 4. Will you hear him? Will you stand with me as we read the word of the Lord? Amen. Acts 2, 1 through 4. Have a seat, man. The word of the Lord declares in Acts 2, 1 through 4, these words. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as a fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Church, say amen.
Amen.
Blessed is the reading of God's word. You may be seated in this house.
Please, so he's
Somebody say purpose.
Purpose.
So you got to know that every one of our lives has purpose. And so today I just want to continue to pour into you what God has given me regarding the church. If we understand, hopefully by now, that the church is not a mission. The church is a movement. Tell your neighbor, the church is a movement.
The church is a movement.
That's what it is. And not only everybody's participating, so that's fine. I'll get you in a few minutes. But I want to help you understand from today's presentation that there are some things that we must make clear about the role of the church. And so today's topic is simply, it's your birthday. Tell your neighbor, it's your birthday.
It's your birthday.
Yeah. And so when we hear that, Amen. We oftentimes think about our birthdays. Amen. How many of you are excited about your birthday? Amen.
You're glad you got a birthday.
One of the things that we really need to understand is when we celebrate our birthdays, we're not expecting to go back through the canal. Amen.
Amen.
And come out again. That's not the purpose of celebrating our birthdays, but we're celebrating the day that we were born. And every year that God gives us, we commemorate that by celebrating on the day that we were born.
Amen.
Well, in retrospect, today, according to the text, not the physical date, but the celebration that's taking place in the text is the day that the church was born. So every time we come together, we should be celebrating the day that the church was born.
Amen.
Now here's something that really tests us, is that when you have a birthday, how do you spend your birthday? A lot of us are sad and we go into this little pity party about how many friends we don't have and if things would have been different, I could have celebrated my birthday the right way. Well, other than being dead, what's the best way to celebrate your birthday is to celebrate being alive.
Amen.
If don't nobody show up to your party, if don't nobody call you, if don't nobody text you or Instagram you, you ought to be excited about your birthday.
Amen.
Because it's the day that you were born. So the church has a birthday. And anytime the church comes together, we should be celebrating our birthday.
Mm-hmm.
And I praise God for this opportunity. I'm not going to be before you long because to try to preach this would be a mistake. I want to present it. Amen.
Amen.
I want to present it in a way, hopefully, that will give you clarity about why it is that the church is what it is. The church is exciting. The church is motivating. The church is sexy. And I want to use that carefully because, you know, we get all bent out of context. I don't want to take it out of context. But it's worth looking at. Let me just say it like that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And so we're excited today that the Lord has given us this very controversial text. The text is controversial because there are so many, and Kill, take somebody and muffle that. I sound like I'm with the circus. Amen. Bring somebody high up. And so the church and this text has been controversial because a lot of times we don't recognize how the devil uses us.
Mm-hmm.
And the devil uses sensuality to separate us. And a lot of times we lean to our own understanding too often. And when you lean to your own understanding and you develop your own interpretation without divine intervention, you come to a conclusion that seemeth right to you, but may not be actually or literally right according to God's interpretation of His Word.
Amen.
And words matter. Tell your neighbor, words matter.
Words matter.
The definition of words matter. Some of us are cognizant of the fact that every word that we use in a statement has a meaning. That's why it's important for you to use the right word at the right time. I study words, and I love big words, but I realize I can't use big words in every place. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
One Sunday, I told you all that Sheree and I had a connubial felicity. And people that are like, what in the heck is that? That's using big words. And a connubial felicity is simply just a happy marriage. That's all it is. But in a room full of intellects, of people who are driven by big words, connubial felicity would have gotten some people excited. Because they didn't know what that word meant, and they had never used it, and they were going to take it home, and while they were baking pork chops, they were going to say, I feel a connubial felicity. You just heard it, and you really didn't know what it means. Amen.
Amen.
And there are a lot of us who use words, and we don't know what they mean. We just heard them, and they just sound great. How many of you really watched the movie Aquila and the Bee? That was one of my most inspirational movies because the breakdown of the dictionary, but the study of words, lets you know how powerful words are.
Mm-hmm.
And we gotta be careful how we use words. Thus, to take it a step further, God's word is powerful. In fact, the word declares that the word is so powerful that it's sharp and quick and sharper than any two-edged sword. So we use the word for the purpose of what design was designed for. And according to Timothy, the word was divinely inspired by God. And the word, all scripture is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, and for correction, and for instruction in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. In other words, you use the word of God as a tool to help you do a better job at being who God called you to be.
Amen. Amen.
And if you're not using the word of God in that capacity, then you're missing out on a treat. So I want to share with you what I believe to be something vitally important to our understanding of the series that we're doing, and that's serving in a purpose-driven church. I need for you to understand something very important that has been controversial for years and years and years, but I want to make it clear in a few minutes if I can. The church is not the building. The church is not the building.
Amen.
There's not one place in Scripture throughout the entire Bible, all 66 letters, that you hear or read where the church is identified as a building. It never was created to be a building. It is not designed to be a building. The worship center or the house of worship or the temple of God is the building. The church are the people who occupy the building. And until we understand what our role is and why we come into this building, we will really never be able to live a purpose-driven life. Because we are beholden to traditions and cultural traditions that have left us without true understanding of who we are. Mm-hmm. And when I say who we are, I'm not talking culturally as a people. I don't even have time to explain that. But if you don't know who we are culturally as a people, you really don't understand who you are as a child of God.
Amen.
Amen. So let me just get busy here and do my work and then get out of your way. So as I look at the text, and I look at these four verses, and I really am thankful to God for helping me to understand that when we build, we're building with the idea that this premise of the church is not the building. We pray that God will open your hearts and your minds to receive and understand what the true role of the church really is. The word church is an English word that was created in our early stages of the first century to describe the group of people that were followers of Christ. In fact, the word church in the English word is taken from the Greek word, which the Greek word is koreakos. Koreakos. And the word koreakos in the Greek means to belong to the Lord. So one thing you leave here with is the church belongs to the Lord. The church does not belong to people. Amen. I hear people say, come and go to my church. My pastor, I remember saying, pastor said, my church is my congregation. We don't have no church. And we don't have no congregation. We don't have no building. It all belongs to God. The part that I love is, you are not my members. Somebody ought to shout Jesus.
Amen.
You belong to God. Because if you were my members, I would rip you and cuss you out. Amen. But because you belong to God, I got to be careful about what I say. You know how it is. You know, we used to be able to whip other people's kids. Amen. Can't do that no more without fear of lawsuits. I grew up in a time where you would whip other people's kids and then you get home and get another whipping. Amen.
Amen.
I'm having somebody else whip you. Amen. But now, because you are God's children, I am not licensed to whip you. But I have been given the responsibility to feed you.
Amen.
Bible says that the role of the pastor is to feed God's people. Feed God's children. And as I'm learning, everybody's diet seems to be different.
Mm-hmm.
But when it comes to the Word of God, it's a universal diet. And you are not to try to find ways to eliminate the Word of God from your life. Don't treat the Word of God like sugar. Amen. Now that some of y'all are living sugar free.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
Glutton free. Now you're trying to make sure that you balance your intake of carbs and potassium, not potassium, what's the other word should we use? Sodium. Because of your physical diet. But you are not to treat God's word and your spiritual diet like you do your physical diet.
Amen.
Some of y'all can go hours and even days without eating. But you are not to do that with the word of God. Because you need the word of God because it's your strength. The word says that the word of God is a lamp unto our feet and light unto our pathway. The word of God is what God uses to help us to become who he has created us to be. Without the word of God, you don't know who you are.
Amen.
So you should want to study the Word of God. You should want to dine on the Word of God. It is a meal that is prepared for you weekly and even daily just to feed your spirit man. How many have ever seen somebody that has been malnourished? If you just turn on the TV on Sunday mornings, amen, and just see all those pictures of people ministering in third world countries. That's how you look on the inside. Without God's word, you're malnourished. And your spirit man is starving. And you here's what happens. When you're starving, you'll eat anything that somebody brings you.
That's right.
Thus is why false prophets are able to rise up and bring you junk food, because you're so malnourished spiritually that whatever they say, you don't eat.
That's right.
Even if it's not healthy for you. Oh my God, I got to spend more time with y'all. Amen. If we really were serious about our diets, there would be no fast food restaurants. The reason why there are fast food restaurants is because there are people who desire to eat junk food.
That's right. Amen.
And they make more money than the healthy restaurants. That means that there are there's an overpopulated society who loves to eat the wrong stuff.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the church is full of people who desire to eat the wrong stuff. And the stuff that we're eating, it doesn't help us in the time of need. It doesn't give us strength. It tears us down. It breaks us down to the point that when the enemy comes, we have no strength to fight.
Amen.
David said, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee, O God." That means if you really want to live a purpose-driven life, the word of God has to be your source. Has to be your reference point. How many of you realize that they don't even put directions in packages anymore?
Mm-hmm.
You get it offline.
That's right.
How many of you go on to YouTube and learn how to do something? Don't be ashamed. Your last five recipes, amen, came from YouTube. So think about that for a minute. If I can go to YouTube and learn how to bake a cake or make a souffle, fix a car, repair an air conditioner, if I can learn all of that from YouTube and I'll use YouTube as a resource, why are people not using YouTube as a resource to get the word?
Amen.
I'm just asking questions today. It's important for me to ask these questions because at the end of the day, we live in a reality where the world is not getting any better.
Right.
And if we're going to survive in this world, we can't depend on this world to feed us what we need to survive. We got to have something that we can go to help us in the time of need. And the word of God is that reference point to help me to survive in this world that I live in. There's nothing on YouTube that tells me how to avoid sin.
Amen.
There's nothing on YouTube to tell me how to get off dope. Because YouTube is designed to help people that are striving to do better, not people who want to do worse.
Amen.
So I joined you today in this assembly to break down these 3 points. Talk about the birth of the church is born. And so many people don't realize it. In Acts 2 was the birthday of the church. Now granted, the church has been misunderstood for so many years because the scripture is misrepresented. The church is not, or this text has always been called upon for people to talk about speaking in tongues. Anytime you read Acts 2, everybody automatically goes to speaking in tongues. Do know this, that the gifts of tongue exist. And when God released the gifts of tongue into the body, he did so with the intent not for us to entertain each other, but for us to use it as a tool in worship. All right, I'll do a little homework here. So I want to step back here and tell you 3 things about the birth of the church. The birth of the church, God used people, places, and power. In the birth of the church, God used people, places, and power. Write that down because you need to know that. Because when you leave here, somebody will say, "What did the pastor preach about?" I don't want you to say you don't know. Say, "The pastor said it's my birthday." And God used people, places, and power to bring the church forth.
Amen.
The church didn't just happen. God had to birth it. Just like you didn't just show up on your doorstep of your mom and daddy, you weren't delivered by stock. And I know you told your kids that. Stop lying to your kids. Amen. There's no bird flying through the air with you hanging out of a napkin being delivered somewhere. You came through a process. And for some people, that process was difficult.
Amen.
But the process is what God used to bring you forth. And a lot of people don't know this. God created the process to make you live at the end of the process.
Amen.
Do you know that the reason why you go through the birth canal is so that everything that's in your system, everything that's in the baby's system, is all fluid? And in order for the fluid to come out, the child has to be squeezed in order for the fluid to come out. And so the reason why the child goes through the birth canal is so that the child can be squeezed. So by the time the child gets to the end of the canal, the child can breathe without choking or suffocating.
Amen.
You have to go through hard times every now and then so God can squeeze some stuff out of you so that when you come through, you can open up your mouth and give God praise.
Amen.
The reason why you don't praise God is because you're choking on your situation.
Amen.
And your problem.
Amen.
God wants you to praise Him. God wants you to go through whatever you're dealing with. So the church is essential because God brought the church forward so that the kingdom of God will have a place for people to come and to do the work that God created. People, I want to share real quick about people. The text says in verse number 1, when the day of Pentecost came. Say Pentecost.
Pentecost.
Historically, got to have some information. Pentecost is a time of the year that is 50 days from Easter. It's a time of the year that is celebrated because the Spirit of the living God moved, and as Christ went through the process of the cross, and we celebrate Easter to commemorate Christ, or the Passover. The time of the Passover was the opening of the way for Christ to celebrate His resurrection. God used Pentecost as a point to redirect or to celebrate the time between Easter and the coming of the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So watch this. Pentecost cannot be repeated.
Mm.
You cannot assimilate Pentecost. You can't pray until the Holy Spirit falls. Ooh. I've heard people say they're going to pray until the Holy Spirit comes. Holy Spirit's already here.
Mm.
You can't pray until the Holy Spirit comes.
Amen.
Because that was a process that God used one time to birth the Holy Spirit and bring the church forward. You do know that, right? That's not going to be another cross experience. You do know that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is not going to keep dying until you get ready. Amen.
Amen.
He's going to keep going to the cross until you finally get it. He's already been to the cross. Salvation is already available. Grace has been afforded to all of us. And so now you don't have to keep going through these things in order for the thing that happened that day to happen again. So what I've learned from this text is that God uses people, and the text shows us that God began to use people to bring the church to where it is at this point in the text. And it didn't start with Jesus in Bethlehem. It started with Adam in the garden. And from Adam in the garden until Jesus on the cross, God used all kinds of people. He used all kinds of people from every level to do what they were designed to do, what they were called to do, what they were purposed to do. So by the time we get to this part, when the church is about to be born, everything that has been done by people, God now allows the work of people to be culminated and to be consummated so that the church can be born. So I love the text because it says they were all in one place on one accord. You know how difficult it is to bring people on one accord?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people don't realize this, but God specifically chose these people to be ready for the birth of the church. If you read in Matthew the 10th chapter, say Matthew 10.
Matthew 10.
The Bible says God called them. He called His disciples together. He called all of the 12 that He had. And the Bible says, and He gave them power. Say power.
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 If you thought about it, the word power in that particular text is not dunamis, but it's exousia. He gave them authority. He gave them authority over all sickness and disease. He gave them authority over all serpents. He gave them authority over all demonic spirits. He gave them authority over them. What does the word authority mean? He gave them the power to be able to command and to direct. So what we have as a part of the church is we have the authority, the exousia in Christ to be able to deal with situations in the earth, and we don't have to be controlled by our circumstance and our situation, because God gave us the authority over our circumstance and over our situation. He gave us the authority over every illness and sickness. And so what does that mean? You and I have the power in Jesus Christ to lay hands and be healed. But the problem is we don't know who we are, so therefore the power that we have been given is not being used.
Amen.
There are too many sick people around, and the church is too powerful for there to be so many sick people around when we have the power over every sickness.
Amen.
Every sickness. Mm-hmm. Every disease. But we don't use that power. But God uses people to bring forth. Say people.
People.
One of the things that about the text is you need to understand that the people are in the room and they're on one accord. You know, it's hard to get people to be on one accord, but when you do, the evidence is in the word.
Amen.
When you can come together with people and be on one accord, God sees that as an opportunity to do something great. Yeah. Which is why we used to say, and I don't know if we still say this, together we stand,
divided we fall.
So if that's the case, that means that the enemy uses division to oppress and to suppress the people of God.
Mm-hmm.
Because the enemy knows what Jesus said.
Right.
A house divided against itself cannot stand. So the enemy keeps us at odds with each other.
Mm-hmm.
He makes it where me and Sheree would have an argument, fall out with each other. One of us would get mad and slam the door or walk away and go do something else. And that dismantles the power of unity in our house, because a house divided cannot stand.
Amen.
So the reason why the enemy puts situations in your way and stumbling blocks so that you cannot walk in the power that has already been given to you.
Mm-hmm.
Division deletes and depresses your power. Because unity lifts you up.
Amen.
So if me and Sheree are walking on one accord, there's nothing we can accomplish. The devil can't come in when we're united. You understand what I'm saying? Sickness don't come in when we're united, because we're walking according to the authority that has been given to us by the Lord Jesus. But when we're arguing and falling out and always yelling at each other, always screaming, now the kids are arguing, now they're falling out with each other, now the division is in the house, now there's all kind of hell looping around the steps of the house, because we're divided and the enemy slips in when you're divided.
Amen.
I lived in a divided house. I grew up in a divided house. So therefore, the enemy was always working in my house. My mother was a praying, still is a praying woman. She was praying then, she praying now. But my daddy wasn't saved. So I remember the time that they would argue about going to church. I remember the morning that the devil used my brother. And he knew my daddy wasn't saved, and we knew it. You know, let me tell you about this for free. Kids will put you, play you against each other.
That's right. They sure will.
Let me say that real quick so all you saved folks will know that. Amen. Kids will make it where you are at odds with each other, because they know that one is for this and one is not.
Amen.
So one morning my brother didn't feel like going to church. He could not argue with my mother about not going to church, because my mother was the authority. She would just pop, and that would be it. The conversation would be over. So the Lord knew that he had put my mother there for a reason. So my brother knew that the Lord had put authority in my mama. And so he went to my daddy and said to my daddy, I don't want to go to church. And that's all my daddy, who is unsaved, needed to hear. So when my mama went to the car and we followed her, Alfred didn't come to the car. She went back in the house and yelled at the door like mamas do. I'm going to give you a few more minutes. You got to come on out here. And she came back out to the car. He wasn't in the car. So she came back in the house and sitting next to my daddy watching football, and he didn't even like football, he said, I'm not going to church. And my daddy, who is unsaved, said, he don't have to go to church if he don't want to. My mama said, go to the car, I'll be out there in a minute. Now you have to know how I grew up. Ain't gonna be no settling without boxing. So I just have to believe that on that day, Lewis Tait hooked a couple of licks, because when Alfred came out the house, Lewis didn't come after him. Amen. Because God had given my mama the authority to deal with unclean spirits.
Amen.
You got to learn how to stand up for your kids against the devil. She wasn't fighting my daddy. She was fighting the spirit in my daddy. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. You ain't got to be in argument with nobody. Just walk in the authority that God has given you as the church. From that day forward, Alfred never missed.
Another day at church.
Another Sunday. He was 14 years old at that time. Ooh. Amen.
Amen.
And I can tell you this. He never watched another football game either. God puts people in your life for two reasons. To help you and to humble you. Mm-hmm. Write that down. God puts people in your life for two reasons. To help you and to humble you.
That's deep.
Now here's what I've learned. We want to go out and select the people we want in our lives.
Amen.
And we had a choice about who was going to be in our lives. How many of y'all know we would select all the good people?
That's right.
God, I thank God for him. I want all the people that ain't got no problems, that ain't creating no headache for me, ain't always nagging about something. Leave them out the room. Lord, let me select the people that I want to be in my life. I tell pastors all the time, we can't select our members, because if we could select our members, none of you would be here today.
That's right.
I'm sorry, Tiffany. I gotta stay focused, but the reality is, if you all could select pastors, y'all wouldn't be here today. Preach, pastor.
I'll be here.
I know some of y'all think that you selected the person that you love, but you didn't. God put them in your life. And some of them showed up. And they ain't from God.
Amen.
Preach, pastor.
Preach, pastor.
I didn't select Evangelist Tait. God did. And God made it where I met her. Then he opened my eyes when she came in the room and said, she's the one. Otherwise, I would have been looking at somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's right.
But when you're serious about being in God's will, everything that happens in your life, God has to put people in your life to help you become a better you. And when you allow God to select the people that are going to be in your life, whether they come to help you or to humble you, they're the right person that's in your life.
Amen.
Paul prayed to God three times. He says, Lord, remove this thorn from my flesh. And many people don't realize that the thorn that he was talking to, what was about, was a nagging lady that was just nagging the heck out of him. And God says to him, my grace is sufficient for you. That means I put her in your life to nag you so that you can stay humble.
That's right.
Because if God does too much for us, many of us will get the hot head or the big head, and we will walk away from God, because once you get too much, you think you don't need God.
That's right. Amen.
Grandma, you say, how do you know he can solve a problem if you never had one? We'll forget about God if we're too successful. Because we'll think it's all about us. Tell your neighbor, people are here for a reason.
People are here for a reason.
So God puts 120 people in the room, Teresa. And then he helps us understand that they come from all walks of life. They come from all backgrounds. They come from all levels of spiritual development. And the reason why God puts the church together is so that he can bring people together to support each other.
Amen.
And to build off of each other.
Amen.
Ooh, I wish I had 30 more seconds to talk about that. And so here's how it works now. This this is how it works, that there are people in the room who are just becoming saved. There are people in the room who have been walking with Jesus a little while. There were people in the room who had been with Jesus for a long time. None of them could supersede the other person, because we learned last week that it's not about position, it's about relationship.
Amen.
And so whatever your relationship with God is, God has created the church so that when you walk into the church, it's not about you, but it's about God. Does that make sense?
Amen.
So the reason why we come to this building is not so we can look up, lift each other up, or to fall superior to one another, or to worship each other. The reason why we come to this building is so that we can worship the one who brought us together.
Amen. Amen.
The word church in the Greek means assembly. The word ekklesia means the called out. So believe it or not, you may not agree with me, but that's your business. I'm going to tell you anyway. God, when you woke up this morning, called you to 434 First Avenue.
Amen. Amen.
We really don't know what the Holy Spirit does. But when you read this text, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit is the driver behind everything that we do.
That's right.
And so when I hear in this text that when they were all one accord and they were in one place, the Bible says they heard a sound. Tell your neighbor, sound.
Sound.
Now, many of you didn't grow up in the South, amen. You've heard about it, but I need for you to understand what sound really means. In those days, when I was growing up, there was a bell at the top of every church, and somebody would go to the top of the steeple and they would ring the bell. And while the bell was ringing, everybody would come out of their homes and they would assemble at the church. Why? Because they were responding to the sound. They didn't have somebody running from door to door, they didn't have email, they didn't have a text message, they didn't have Instagram. All they had was the bell, and once they heard the sound of the bell, everybody assembled to where the sound was coming from. And
amen.
So we hear about the birth of the church. They're in one place, in one accord, and God sends a sound. And the sound is evidence that you're in the right place at the right time.
Amen. Amen.
Why? Because God was about to birth the church. Anytime there's a birth, there has to be a sound from heaven. Doctors will not tell you this, but pastors won't reveal it to you if you do your own research. Nobody knows why and how the water breaks with the female when it's time for the child to come. But you need to know that the sac is pierced by a sound from heaven.
Wow.
And that's what breaks the sac. Because God is getting ready to bring forth.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
Your child does not have a knife to cut open the sac.
That's right.
But the sack is simply responding to the sound from heaven. And the sound is so powerful that the sound breaks through. Pastor, what are you saying? When God got ready for the church to be born, he led out with a sound.
Amen.
Gary, what you got on that new instrument? You got wind on that? Find me some wind. Find me some wind. You got wind? Find wind. I'm almost finished. But I gotta have wind. When you find a play, that ain't wind. That's my wind. Turn it up. When they were all in one place, on one accord, God released a sound from heaven. Play that sound. Bless it up. Blow it out. Now watch this. He says, play the sound again. This is a similar, small similar, what it sounded like. Turn up. So can you imagine that while they were sitting there, while they were praying, while they were waiting on God, there a sound came that was more powerful than that playing, brother, than playing, brother. Now, we got to mix up. Somebody thought that the wind came in the house, but the wind never came in the house. The text says it was a sound as of a mighty rushing wind. Y'all
wow.
Got words.
Wow.
So it was the sound that filled the house and not the wind.
Wow.
Because if the wind had come into the house at that level, the house would have been torn down.
Amen. Amen.
Now this is
a Amen.
I know this ain't got something you want to hear, but I need to hear it anyway. So I said, shh, and says, and there appeared unto them tongues as a fire, and it sat upon each of them.
Wow. Glory.
Baba, tell me now, because somebody going to say, you, Pastor ain't telling the truth, but I want you to know I am. The word says, set means to take a seat and be appointed to. What I'm trying to say to you is that when the Spirit of the Living God comes into a room, it will only connect with the people.
That's right, that's right.
Who understand,
that's right,
that they're in the right place at
that's
the right,
right
time.
That's right.
The reason why we hear and it sat upon each of them was for no other reason other than verse number one. They were in one place on one accord.
Amen.
So what does that mean? You don't know. When they saw it, it was as if it was tongues. And the Bible says the word tongues here means that it was an individual thing. And it sat upon. Can I sit on you? How much weight can you have?
I can take.
And it sat upon each of them. You understand what I'm saying? Say, Tait never get connected with me.
He connected with me.
It sat upon each of them. So it wasn't a corporate thing. It was an individual thing. What are you saying, Pastor? That my gifts and what God is going to do for me is individual.
That's right.
I want you to rehear this. The reason why God created the church was so that there would be a place that you and I can come to.
Glory.
Some Kool-Aid, but when they get to you, the Kool-Aid runs out. How does that make you feel? Like you've been left out. Oh my goodness, I can't believe everybody. You can't go with that until you get some Kool-Aid. Here's how God works. You never see somebody come with another pitcher and they start pouring where they left off.
Right.
I need you to know God's supply never runs out.
Amen.
And you don't have to rob somebody else.
Amen.
And get what you think you want.
Amen.
Just be patient and wait on God.
That's
God
right.
Give you what
that's
you
right.
Want. You hear me?
Amen.
God is not like your empty pitcher of Kool-Aid. The tongues came and sat upon each of them.
Glory.
Watch this. And then they were filled with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Wait a minute. The tongues came before the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Because God did not want us to misunderstand.
That's right.
That the Holy Spirit is not about tongues.
Glory.
The tongues were real. And the gift of tongues are real.
Mm-hmm.
And they're flowing in the church. But not because I got the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
The gifts of God are without repentance. Means that God will give his gifts to anybody that he wants to.
Amen.
Without us even knowing who was in the room.
That's right.
They all received the gift of tongues. And then they were filled. Watch this now. The tongues sat on them externally. The Holy Spirit filled them internally.
Amen.
Tell your neighbor, do your homework.
Do your homework.
We have made it where people feel like they don't have a connection with God because they don't speak in tongues. But what this evidence shows us is that I can have the gift of tongues.
That's right.
And not be filled.
That's right.
With the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen.
But what consummates the gift of tongues is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit.
Glory!
They had the gift of tongues, but they couldn't use it until the Holy Spirit filled them.
Amen.
You can have a gift, but if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you're not going to know how to use that gift.
Amen.
That was too heavy, amen. I can tell you that it was too heavy, Pastor.
Too heavy.
I can't even. So let me hurry along. I got too excited now. God showed me that I had to go back and repent. Watch this now. And it filled each of them.
Mm-hmm.
And then they spoke as the Spirit gave them
utterance. Amen.
They didn't start speaking when the tongues failed.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't start speaking until after the Holy Spirit came in.
All right.
The Holy Spirit didn't come into the room. It came into their hearts.
Amen. Amen.
God does not send the Holy Spirit to sit in this building until you come back week after week. He made it where you take the Holy Spirit home with you. And whatever you're dealing with at home, that's where the power of the Holy Spirit
works. That's right.
Whatever you're dealing with at work, that's where the power of the Holy Spirit works. Whatever you're dealing with around your community, that's where the power of the Holy Spirit works. Wherever you are. Wait a minute, what does that mean? That means that this must not be the church. That means that I am the church. And wherever the church is operating, that's where the Spirit of the Lord is.
Amen.
The reason why you haven't taken your house back because you don't understand the power that you have. Kingdom suffering violence.
Glory.
I'll take it by force. That don't mean I'm out there fighting again. Just means I'm walking in the authority.
That's right.
That God has given me as his child. I'll never be able to tell my kids I don't know what to do with you. Yes, I do. Because I got the power of the Holy Spirit working in me. And I know exactly what to do. Because they are experiencing seasons in their lives. Just like you came through a season. And your mom and dad knew what to do for you. And if they didn't, you know better now. Amen. Because you're in a season. And for everything, there is a season. There's a time to cry and a time not to cry. There's a time to
Ooh, Jesus.
That's why the enemy has used the chastisement of our children to tear up the family. That's why they can call 241 kids now. Because we don't know what season they're in.
Amen.
If you know what season they're in, you know it wasn't time for you to do what you did. Don't give the devil room to execute his master plan.
Amen.
What is the devil's master plan? Jesus told you you should know it, but I'll remind you. The thief coming to steal, to kill,
and
to destroy.
Amen.
Every chance the enemy gets, he's working from those three perspectives. To kill you, to rob you, and to destroy your life.
Amen.
He robs you of your peace. He robs you of your joy. He robs you of your happiness. He robs you of anything that gives you safety in God. And then he uses it to destroy your life.
Amen.
The reason why God gave us the church is so that you and I will have an opportunity to be surrounded by the right people.
Mm-hmm.
To be in the right place.
Amen.
I love that part of it. In Luke 24, he says, tarry ye here in Jerusalem. And this is where your blessing is going to come.
Amen.
The reason why many of us have not received the blessing from God that we've been praying about is because we're in the wrong place.
Mm.
We want God to send the blessing wherever we are.
Right.
When the word is already declared that God is going to bless you as long as you're in the place that he's assigned to you. So I'm in Cincinnati only because God told me so. Otherwise, I would be living in St. Louis.
Mm-hmm.
Because from 1996, is that right, Sheree? 95 to 2003, the blessings for our life was in St. Louis, Missouri. When God got ready to bless us in Cincinnati, he had to start taking away the blessings in St. Louis.
Wow.
Because otherwise, I would have never left St. Louis.
Amen.
Y'all missing it.
Amen.
Our most precious asset in St. Louis was our home that we had bought. The first time we bought our beautiful home, we loved it. Acre of land, beautiful home, everything that we worked for. And when God got ready to move us, he caused us to lose the house through foreclosure. And so they came and took the house. We lived out of a U-Haul truck for a week. So we were homeless for a week. And then God opened the way for us to have an apartment. And they would only give us a month-to-month lease.
Wow.
Because God knew we were only going to
be there for a short time.
Time.
That's right. That's right.